I am going to go ahead and get started, and I'm going to do that first by saying we are so thrilled to have you with us here today. Thank you, and we have known each other for a little while now, four of us, so I just want to explain how it is that what's going on here. I hope you all did get the case about HCL, and we're actually in the midst of writing a new case that should have been released. I'm a little slow in my research associate, but we're continuing to study what's going on at HCL. Because as I mentioned to you, I like to follow leaders over time, and fortunately, HCL's been willing to put up with me since 2005.
Yeah.
Yes, and so it's 10 years now, I guess, that you've put up with me. Uh-oh, we're getting old together here. So I ended up, as I mentioned very quickly, and you may not have recalled this because a lot's been going on since yesterday, is that when we were doing our work on leading innovation, we mostly wanted to look at leaders who had reputations for building organizations that could innovate time and again. But we also wanted to look at leaders who were in the process of trying to transform their organization into an innovative engine. And HCL, I was introduced to Vineet Nair, who'd just become the CEO of HCL, and was told that that was the journey he was on. And I was recently, I guess last year, Vineet was earlier in the year, was at my home for dinner, and we were discussing the fact that he said, you had faith in me, that in fact this was going to work out all right. And I will tell you that I guess I did have faith in him, but I hadn't realized that he saw it that way. But I was very eager to actually just look at a company that was trying to do this, and we wrote the case about it. And as the years went on, I was pretty sure you were going to be in the book for sure, right? So, but he said one of those, but I didn't know that we would end up in the book or not, and I hadn't actually really thought about that, but of course they did. And we continue to have a very positive relationship, and I've learned a great deal from you and your colleagues, and I appreciate that. But to get us started, we just decided I wanted to share the financials, some of the success of this organization. So when Vineet took over as CEO, or was appointed CEO, one of the things you will see if you read the case is that he was not sure he could do this. He was reluctant to take the job because he didn't know that he was necessarily prepared to take on that kind of leadership responsibility. But he did do that, and I, as I said, had the pleasure of sort of watching over the years as they began to do this transformation. And what we're going to do is, you're going to really just talk with us about the transformation process, and you're going to take about 25 minutes to a half an hour to do that, and then we'll take some questions here, and you can ask whatever you'd like to ask, and then we'll go to dinner, and we'll have some other time for questions too. We'll just have a microphone there if people have other questions they want to pursue. But I can't say enough about how much I've actually enjoyed working with all of you. So let me get out of the way, and shall I put your presentation up? But I think that you'd all be pleased. And as Vineet said, we were about to become irrelevant. And I guess no one would say you're irrelevant at this point in time.
I wouldn't say that.
No, not for sure. So thank you very much for being with us, Purva. We really appreciate it.
Thank you, Lena.
I have a very host role.
I have a small question. You have shown the growth in revenues and the improvements in revenue per employee.
Yeah.
They're not showing the improvement or growth in profit.
I'll talk about it. That's a very good question. So, but
that's
to answer your question.
Not his.
Sorry.
A ridiculous leadership professor that doesn't give you the data you really need. Yeah.
That's a very confidential data.
Yes.
Yeah, but don't give you a. So I was fortunate enough to join HCL. Firstly, my introduction, I'm the Vice President of Marketing at HCL. And I started with the company in 2005. So pretty much lived through the transformation and all the exciting stuff which we did there and which we are still doing. And in my industry, in software services, it's pretty common for people to change jobs every 3-4 years. So it's 12 years, I'm still going strong, loving every moment of it. And when I joined in 2005, we just got a new CEO, Vineet Nair, and he's written the book called Employees First, Customer Second. Some of you might have read it. And I'll just share our experiences on what happened. And to answer Manish's question, we were at about 12.5-13%, if I remember correctly, EBIT. And today we are at about 24%. So not only have we expanded our market share, our market cap has gone from about 2.5, 3 billion to 20 billion in 10 years. So it's been an interesting journey. So we always like to start with this slide because there are two kinds of companies. there are the how companies and there are the what companies. HCL is all about the how and it's not about the what. And let me explain the difference between both. The what companies are the companies which will invent the driverless car and they're all about products. The secret sauce in HCL's success or relative success has always been about the how. The secret sauce for us has been the power of employees, harnessing the power of employees to really drive the company. So there are three values which we all at HCL believe in. The first is employees first, customer second. Now, some of it, it's been called various things like management buzzword, smart marketing speak, and I'll talk a little bit about it as we go ahead. The second is trust, transparency, and flexibility. Extremely important because classically in IT services or even in large companies, information is power. And people learn very early on in their careers to withhold information and they drive that power from it. So it's an interesting take on that. The third is value centricity. In large deals, in our industry, an average deal, and I see a lot of people from PwC and other software companies here, or consulting companies, in our industry, an average deal is about $25-30 million. And often people end up thinking that these deals are won on the basis of social relationships. A lot of business happens over golf. While for us, it's always been about value-centric relationships. These are not social relationships. We did something very interesting. Vineet, our previous CEO, was an outstanding marketer, change leader. But he pretty much restrained the marketing team and he said, till we get our internal transformation right, you're not going to market. You're not advertising. You're not going to rent the billboards. So the advertising which you see in India is actually done by our parent company and not by HCL Technologies. You would never see a HCL Technologies ad. It's all by the parent company, and we are one of the companies in the parent company. And Vineet said, in a services company, especially when we are claiming that we are employees first, customer second, it is important to get it right. And the real moment of magic is not between two CEOs. It's not about two CEOs shaking hands and committing to a deal. Actual customer transformation happens when a delivery guy talks to a customer. That's the moment of truth. And all of us at senior management have to be accountable to delivery employees. And that's when the magic will happen. And I don't want you to go to market. I want the marketing team to work with me on driving internal transformation. So every couple of years, we would get frustrated, go up to him with the next big campaign idea. And he would say, didn't we discuss this just 2 years ago? And you guys are not going to give up. But finally, we felt after 7.5-8 years of brutal slog, that we are a state where the culture is very well understood in the company and we need to give the proper noun, culture, a name. And we came up with this catchy phrase called ideapreneurship, which is a combination of two words, ideas and intrapreneurship. Because we firmly believe HCL does not have employees. We have 110,000 ideapreneurs. We don't have 9-to-5 employees, we have entrepreneurs. And the company encourages everybody to think like that. And the promise which we make to our customers is relationship beyond contract. So contracting is when an employee stops and an entrepreneur takes over. In our industry, most of the projects or a large part of projects are time and material. And we believe the model is quite weird. Because in which other industry you get compensated whether your customer does well or not? So it's a model which is not sustainable. And you keep charging your hourly rates in consulting, and part of your revenue is linked to customer outcomes, but not a significant part. So let's go back to 2005 and let's talk about what really happened there. So it was a very, very tough time for HCL. Vineet had taken over, and most people called it a thankless job because the company had lost market share. If you flash back 8-9 years ago, in 1999, at one time HCL was larger than Infosys. I don't know how many people would remember that. Yeah. And what really happened is when Y2K happened, a lot of our peers got into Y2K remediation and they started doing very well. we focused on core R&D, research and development. And because we focused on research and development, we were constrained in Silicon Valley. We were working with the Ciscos and, you know, internet companies of that time. And we really didn't other Fortune 500 companies. So we lost market share. In 2005, our stock price had started crashing. Most of the investors had written up on us. And this was a very, very bad. There used to be this phrase called switch. Switch was nothing but Satyam, Wipro, Infosys, TCS, and HCL. And we were even surprised that we were about to switch. We were almost like, you know, out of the game. And people were like, HCL is not going anywhere. In fact, when I joined HCL in 2005, I used to work for Daiichi, which is a pharmaceutical company. And people told me, they said, are you making the right career decision? You're joining a sinking ship. And I just spoke to a few seniors in the industry and they said, we've heard they've got a great CEO, Vineet. And we are very confident he'll turn the company around. And you'll be a part of the change. So it's a good decision to join it. I took a leap of faith, it's worked out well. Let's see what happened. So when we decided we'll be a how company and not a what company, we said, let's ask some very, very simple questions. The first question which we asked is, fundamentally, what's the role of business? It's to create value. Value for employees, value for shareholders, value for customers. Every growth business is in the business of creating value. And who creates the value? It's usually not the managers. It's usually not the CEO. It's usually not the chairman. It's usually not the board. It's usually not the investors. It's the employees, right? And when we had defined that, it suddenly made us very, very laser sharp focused. And we said, in a company, that time we were, I think, about 18,000 employees. Out of 18,000 employees, about, I would say, 16,000 were software delivery employees. And rest were managers, enabling functions, HR, legal, finance, ops. Why don't we laser sharp the company's focus on employees? And let's see what that turns out to be. We said, if your focus is on employees and employees create value, what should be the role of managers? These 1,500, 2,000 managers in the company. And we said, the only role of managers that time should be to encourage, enthuse, and empower employees. And they should get out of the way, they should stop destroying value, and they should, their only role should be to take care of the employees so that the employees can take care of the customers. And I remember we had a famous customer event. We used to call it Global Customer Meet. And Vineet got up on the stage and he basically told our customers, he said, we've had a moment of epiphany and we've decided for us, it's always going to be employees first and customers second. And we saw a couple of what did he just say? Did he really mean it? Because in most Fortune 500 Global 2000 companies, it is, you know, customer centricity is the buzzword. And if you're not customer-centric, you're like, what are you doing? And here's the CEO of the company telling its top customers that we are employees first and customers second. And Vineet basically said, we are very clear, this market will commoditize. Software services will commoditize. And soon you're going to have self-healing code, you're going to have autonomics, you're going to have machine learning, and a lot of stuff is going to be done not by people. And the people who are really, really capable will need to be taken care of so that they can take care of customers. And it was very interesting. And he basically said, to enable that, we only want to work with few customers. That time, our long tail of customers was huge. We used to work with many customers. For some customers, we used to only do $500,000, $1 million, $1.5 million. And I think our revenue, if I remember correctly, was about $760, $780 million. And at that time, the CEO to say that we will work with fewer customers, and if you decide not to scale up your engagement with HCL and become more significant for us, and make us more significant for you, I'm sorry, but we'll need to part ways. It was a very, very bold statement to make. Here is a company which is not doing well, and which is asking its customers to either become more significant or part ways. So a lot of people in the industry wondered, what are these guys up to? Are they even real? And let's watch how the story turns out. Now, we said, you know, there are going to be some key tenets on which the transformation will rest. The first tenet is going to be mirror, mirror. Every HCL employee will need to be our harshest critic. It is not customers, it's not analysts, it's not media. We will have to be our harshest critics. And if we do that, we will become bulletproof monks. There is nobody who is going to be able to have the ability to shoot holes through us. And we used to have these leadership meetings, very, very emotionally charged, where people who were really passionate about the company used to get up and say that we suck at this, we suck at testing, our HR processes are broken, this doesn't work in the company. And the way the meetings would go is, pretty much the CEO and senior leaders would say, I think you're absolutely right, this doesn't work. Would you like to take up the project to fix it? So immediately, you know, hands started going up and we started fixing the company. Second was actually encouraging employees to trust us and creating the culture for change. Now change, as all of us know, is very, very uncomfortable. Most people operate in the comfort zone and not in the courage zone. So how do you get people to move out of their comfort zone and actually operate in the current zone for a higher proportion of time, right? In our industry, the source of competitive advantage often is fleet management, are the cabs on time, leave management. It's a different kind of industry because you're managing scales of people. And people very soon become comfortable with managing all transactional activities and they give up trying to change the company, trying to innovate. So how do you get people to become comfortable with change? And building a culture for change and building a structure. And one of the interesting things we did is we said, in a typical conventional company, you have a pyramid, which is a leadership pyramid, with the CEO at the top. And the CEOs are often given godlike status. They're always right, they have all the answers. And we said, you know, I'm just a human being like many others. You've trusted me to become a CEO, but let's flip the triangle. And all of us will be accountable and let's believe in the power of and the wisdom of the masses. And all of us will be accountable. And we will crowdsource ideas and we will be completely transparent. The next phase of the transformation was actually transferring the responsibility of change. And where Vineet said, I'm only one person. My direct reports are only 6 or 7 people. So whenever you have to take a decision, don't wait for us, don't look at us, we don't have all the answers and we might not always be available. Please take the decision, if you go wrong, ask for forgiveness and tell us what you learned. And hopefully that will work well. Not all decisions which we took turned out well, but it just made us a more entrepreneurial, capable company which believed in its people. So this is an interesting chart which actually shows the way we have flipped the pyramid. So this is the conventional management pyramid. We have flipped it where customers, employees, supervisors, and it's the whole concept of servant leadership, where management is actually reversely accountable to employees. And this is the value zone. This is the moment of magic between employees and customers. Now, this was the idea, although it looked very radical, it was almost brilliant in its simplicity. It was the most obvious thing to do in a services company. Now that in hindsight, when you look at it. Now we said it can't only be poetry. It can't only be feelings. It can't only be emotional. How do you configure the management systems in a way that the innovation, that the transformation becomes hard-coded to the DNA of the company? And we came up with very interesting things. First was talent transformation. With no disrespect to executive education programs, we basically said, yes, you can go out and learn from business schools, you can learn out from other people, but often the responsibility for teaching employees is your internal talent. And we created, and we said it's everybody's job to train. We shut down our learning and development team that time, and we said, the moment you have a centralized learning and development team, everybody looks at them for training. It is everybody is important to hire well and train well. And there were bonus points, we gamified the experience. We created an employee first academy, which means anybody who got onboarded to HCL was trained on our culture, values. More importantly, what employee first was not. It is very important that people understood that employee first was not about free food in the cafeteria. It was not about, you know, a golf cart to go between offices, because again, in technology and software, that's the frame of reference. Most people end up thinking it's the free meal, it's the Segway, bikes, it's the ESOPs. While we actually said, no, it just means we'll trust you, you'll behave like an entrepreneur, you'll do what you feel like doing, and you'll do what is right for the company. In a nutshell, that's employees first. We created something called EPIC, Employee Passion Count Indicator, which basically measured employees. When you're doing a massive transformation on an 18,000 people company, which pretty much lasted or is still ongoing, to a company which today is 110,000 people. It's like trying to change all four wheels of the car while the car is at 110. Very, very tough. You have to ensure that the car is not going off the road. And EPIC is what helped us keep measuring what percentage of employees are fence sitters, what percentage of employees are believers in the transformation, what percentage of employees are advocates, and so on and so forth. We started having this management event called Directions. Now, in most companies, the strategy of the company is often known only to very few people. It's often not published in a case study. It's often not what you read in media articles. It's known to very few people. And we found this very, very surprising. And we said, how do we get to point B from point A if nobody knows what is the path? We encouraged everybody, it still happens every year, to record their business plans, including financial numbers, profitability targets, customer acquisition targets, service delivery metrics, and record that whole plan and leave it on a portal so that any employee can see it. Any employee can comment on it. It's an intranet. You can log in, you can listen to the recording, you can add a comment, you can tag other people. And we said, that's the way to do it. Because we trust our employees, we believe in intentionality. And if we trust them, we have to show it. And let everybody crowdsource. Let everybody comment. And that was Directions. And Directions used to be a public forum. It's become, because the company has become larger, it's become a smaller forum now, where the leaders would present their plan to some very hard and extreme criticism from employees. And it was almost like America's Got Talent, where the leader is presenting the plan, but the judges are employees. And who would say, are you serious? You want to do this? I think that's a terrible idea. So the feedback was very direct, hard. We said, while the employee experience is getting transformed, the management ways of working, the management ethos needs a transformation as well. Two sides of the same coin. So we created something interesting. 80,000 employees, about 2,000 managers. We said in our industry, trouble ticketing is a way of doing business. So if your SAP system does not work, or whatever, Oracle system doesn't work, you raise a trouble ticket. Right? And you use a Remedy or one of these ticketing tools, a Freshdesk or a Zendesk. And we said, let's create a trouble ticket system for all functions in the company. HR, legal, finance, your managers, the CEO. Everybody was on a trouble ticketing system, still is, with SLAs. And we basically said, if you feel HR is not running, training properly or whatever, or your payroll is messed up, raise a trouble ticket on them. And if all department heads used to get a rag status, they still do, which had what are the tickets open, what tickets have been closed in time, what is the customer satisfaction, employee satisfaction on those tickets. So we flipped the whole model. We said we will do a executive connect between employees and managers. And we started a portal which still runs called You and I, where anybody in the company could ask the CEO questions. And these questions could be on anything. It could be on, why are our facilities in the worst part of the town? To, why do our buses not run on time? To, I think we are doing this very well, why don't we do more of it? And the CEO basically said, we'll answer every question. What we will do is we will categorize questions, because some of the questions might be similar, to make it manageable for me. But even today, our CEO answers all questions. It's a core tenet of the company. In my team, I run marketing, a large part of marketing. I'm responsible for answering those questions. These questions are publicly. They can't be edited. So good, bad, ugly, they're out there in the open. You have to answer it. The third thing we said is we will create an employees first governing council, which will have nobody above middle management level. All the people who are a part of the council will be middle management and below. In fact, very few middle managers. Because we said if you leave this to management, they will destroy it. The CEO might change, the middle management might change. Leave it to people who are really affected by it. Make it a self-governing model where the people who are affected by the company policies actually have a say in it. The last thing which we did, which me and Linda were speaking about just before the session started, is 360 feedback. Now, most of the companies which you work with would have something like 360 feedback. Now, the interesting thing about our 360 was it was completely transparent and open for everybody to see. So a couple of years ago, one of our very senior leaders, one of the direct reports of the CEO, 41% people said he doesn't listen well. Some said he doesn't listen at all. He already knows all the answers. So now the interesting thing is when you make feedback public and it's available for everybody to see, it pushes the management to change. The pressure on them to change is very high. Because it is public pressure, it's peer pressure, otherwise they will get the same feedback next year. We said 360 feedback is not mandatory. It is not linked to your promotions. It is not linked to your compensation growth. We believe you. We are doing this so that you get the feedback which allows you to be successful. We are not going to penalize if you get bad feedback. And to encourage employees, when we started this, to give feedback, 100% of the top management made their feedback public. That was the first year. And we told people, you can choose for your name to be known, or you can make the feedback anonymous. We really don't care. And the expectation was, half of the people thought most of the people would have their names anonymous. Not even half, actually. 60-70% people, if I remember correctly, thought most of the people will leave anonymous feedback. 30% said, we know these employees. They are honest. They will put their names. Surprisingly, 70% names were there. People gave name feedback and people said, this is me, I work in this team, you might not know me, but this is my feedback on you, Mr. CEO. And so on and so forth. So, now, when we rolled it out, different people responded to it differently. The fence setters said, let me watch, they're doing this for a year. This will raise so much stink that they will shut it down next year. The believer said, this is great, I'm completely for it. The naysayer said, this is a terrible idea. I would never do this, and I can't wait to get off the ship. And we said to each one of its own, this is getting done. It's worked very well, it's still very popular, and a lot of us work on that feedback, and it's great. With this, I just wanted to show you a small video.
Using the graphic properties, resolution a bit, so the entire screen is...
Okay, why don't we go back to the presentation, I can show the video.
Oh, here it is. Please go back there, okay. It went beyond my capabilities.
Okay, just bear with me. This is a video which we created in 2005.
Make it bigger.
It's called the Employees First, Customer Second Effect. And it has nothing to do with customers. This was our film which we showed at the customer meet. Full screen.
Right. It's 8 a.m. Millions of employees show up each day with their names on a register. The world we see around us. Country.
Minimize everything.
Reduce the zoom.
Yes and no. What we'll do is let's go through some of the conversation, and then if we have time, we can see the videos. I wanted to put the videos because I know it's been a long day for you, and it gives some relief. So let's talk about what started happening. We've spoken about the first part of transformation, which was management-led and employee-based. And then we wanted to institutionalize the innovation or the management transformation and actually make it employee-led and management-based so that it's more sustainable. Now, what started happening? The second phase of transformation, our revenues almost grew 2.5 times, steep growth. A lot of our customers started becoming very significant. And all this data is publicly available. The other interesting thing about HCL is, if you see our financial report, you pretty much have all the data available. Yeah.
So what is CSAT?
Customer satisfaction.
Sorry
about that. Yeah. So customer satisfaction, almost all client-facing roles, their 30% of their bonus is linked to customer satisfaction. So it's a completely focused, aligned. Our customer satisfaction increased by 87%. The way it is measured is HCL does not measure it. There is a third-party firm which actually records customer feedback. About 10,000 customers are surveyed. They are across levels, so right from CIOs to chief procurement officers to chief digital officers now, 10,000 customers are surveyed. It happens every year. There have been years where we've been done it twice. It's completely anonymized, so you see it by levels, you see it by industries, you see it by functions, and we work very hard on it.
How are you placed with respect to your competitors?
So this data is not publicly disclosed by competition. Our data is publicly available. A lot of competition does not disclose this publicly.
But you have your market intelligence, you can get the data.
Very hard. I personally think even the methodologies would differ. So it's very hard to compare apples to oranges. Their sample size would differ. Their industry focus would differ. But we like to think we are on the right path here. We're very, very internally focused. The other interesting thing about HCL is we are not at all competition focused. We're very, very employee focused. We don't want to be blindsided by what competition is doing. It's great. We are aware. We are not completely unaware of what competition is doing. But we are very, very focused on employees and customers. You will not see a lot of competition conversation happening in HCL. There is no desire to be the largest software companies, consulting company in the world. There is an immense amount of desire to be the best run company, the most employee focused company. So the conversations are very, very different.
Excuse me, yeah. Did your OPEX increase with employee related costs?
As a percentage or overall?
Relatively, not considering the staff increase, because you said you were employee focused, did you give them incentives?
That's a very good question, no. So, it is not a what company. A what company would focus on increasing compensation. A what company would increase ESOPs, would buy those golf carts. It's a how company. We just focused on changing the experience of employees. By making them more empowered to take decisions,
there is a very famous study, I think it might be by Gallup, and Linda, correct me if I get it wrong, which basically says most of the employees work for three things: autonomy, purpose, and mastery.
Right.
And a lot of managers will end up thinking that people work only for money or people switch.
Yeah.
So, I don't want to interfere, but one of the things, if you look in the case, there is a discussion of when you put in, I don't know if you still have it, because Vineet made a big point of not, you know, nothing should stay,
yeah.
Trust pay.
Yeah.
So when the change first happened, if you want to talk a little bit about that.
Yeah,
what happened with
thank
that.
You for bringing this up.
Yeah.
In fact, 2008, and the markets had started collapsing, Lehman Brothers went down. Very, very tough year for the industry. When most of our competition was laying off people, left, right, and center. We came out publicly and said, we will not lay off even one person, other than for performance reasons. There is going to be no retrenchment because employees don't take a lot of decisions. Strategy is mostly set and executed by senior managers. So why should employees get penalized? And we said, we will trust you, the pay is called trust pay, and you will remain and you will get your bonus. And we will absorb. So our EBITs went down further.
What kind of board do you have?
It's a very, very interesting board. I think there are 10 to 11 people, including three very senior women execs, including one exec who was the CEO of Apple in North America. It's a diverse board. There is a Harvard Business School professor, Professor Srikant Dattar, who is Linda's colleague. It's a completely professional board. The owners or the promoters only have one representation out of 10.
The initiative that you have for employee first seem to be really interesting, right? Just out of curiosity, what is the attrition rate in HCL?
I don't know what is the current, but it is, I would say, about 200-300 basis points lower than the industry. And in our industry, even 0.5% is huge. 50 basis points is also huge. It varies. Our BPO business has slightly higher attrition. Our engineering business has, like, amazingly, it's below 5% attrition. So we do about $1 billion in engineering services. Attrition is below 5%. Right? Other data point is we have an extraordinary high number of rehires. So I like to joke with our CHRO and other people, HCL is like a bad habit. You can't live with it, you can't live without it. We have a very, very high number of rehires. So the number of people who come back in the first 18 months after leaving is very, very high. And they could be quitting for many reasons, because software engineers go on to do their MBAs and stuff like that. So a lot of people join us back after their MBAs. Yes.
Since you were talking about the employees, I was just wondering, at the high level, how many of the management, the senior management, are homegrown HCL people, or their lateral hires? Because with this transparency and all these, you know, unique things, lateral hires coming from another organization may feel uncomfortable. So what's the makeup of your senior management team?
So it's a mix, because we've also done acquisitions, including a very large one, which we did recently for Volvo IT. It's a mix, but I would say 60-65% is homegrown. Both our CEOs have been lifers, the previous one and the current one. I've been there for 12 years, 11 and a half, 12 years, and my tenure would be one of the least. Like, and it's not that we don't welcome people from other cultures with open arms. It is just that our employees do so well and they grow so fast.
Thank you.
One of your bigger acquisitions was, when did you do Axon?
Axon was 2008, December, 2009. January, it was about that time $900 million. The largest ever acquisition by an Indian IT company. And that brought in a lot of senior management. So one of the interesting things about HCL is today we have people, out of 110,000 people, we have people from 98 nationalities. Almost 50,000 non-Indians. So it's not a typical Indian IT lift and shift model where you hire only from India and deploy. It is a global model. One of the highest percentages of non-Indian employees is in HCL. Yeah.
When you did this transformation, when the company transformed, or when you do these acquisitions, how did you handle, because your employee first is the goal, how did you make sure that your existing employees, the older employees, are able to move along with you in that transition? What was the strategy?
Question, thanks for asking. Now, I'll give you a layered answer. So when you're acquiring a company, we are always very clear that we will not only hire for market reach or capability. Most acquisitions fail. I'm sure most of you are aware of it. They're often driven by board egos or the CEO's ego, and most acquisitions fail. We were very clear that the top reason for acquiring, after you know there being a product market fit, competency gap which we have identified, would be cultural values. We would never acquire a company which we really need but is not culturally aligned to us. You can't mix an apple and orange and make something nice. When we end up acquiring such a company, we will make sure that it is not a command and control acquisition. A lot of companies, as soon as they acquire the company, they finish out the brand, they kill the HR processes, and it's like a template. The template is implemented and you go live. Within 1 week, the sales guys get a quota for the next company, next company's products. Right? It sounds familiar. In the case of acquisition, we said, Axon acquisition, we said it will be a reverse acquisition. We are acquiring Axon because they are the leaders, world leaders in SAP implementation. They understand value engineering, you know, and stuff like that really well. Our SAP practice is modern. We will do a reverse acquisition. We acquired Axon, merged our SAP practice with them, and let them run it. 100% of their management stayed back with us. They did fantastically well. They grew. And we said, they know their stuff. Why would we acquire a company, kill their culture, kill everything? Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken, so you said 2008 was when you acquired this company for $900 million, which is a big acquisition. Yeah. And then that was the same year when the stock price dropped 60% in the next year. Yeah. So being in a similar boat myself, we acquired an Italian company and our share prices dropped. Different figures, but same concept. What made you, now this is directed to you and not the company, didn't you feel like abandoning ship? What made you stick with the company with such a major acquisition proving such a significant drop in share price?
So I think one of the things, and you will get the same answer if you speak to anybody who is a HCL veteran or people who have been there for years. We love what we do. We are not employees. You will have good times, you will have bad times. And either case, we are ready for it. So never for a moment we had a doubt that we'll be able to turn it around.
So such was the faith in the CEO?
Such was the faith in employees first, customer second. It was much larger. It is much larger than the CEO. CEOs will come and go, but there is the whole nucleus, the cultural nucleus of the company. It's like hard-coded. It's like an operating system. The operating system will not fail you.
Thank you.
How do customers take this employee first, customer second philosophy? How do your customers take this employee first, customer second philosophy?
So there are many kinds of customers. There are customers like Cisco, Microsoft, who've been with us for many years. They understand it very well. And some of the practices they've actually taken from us and implemented it. In fact, there are customers who've asked us, why don't you convert into a model like GE's Six Sigma, where HCL creates a methodology. It's like CMM level 5. And we can become an employees first, customer second organization. And you certify us. And we said, it's great, but we don't want to IP it. It's free for anybody to use. And we can help you. First kind of customers. The second kind of customers are customers who've just joined the HCL family. We've just started working with them. Again, we don't go after all kinds of customers. So when we qualify a deal, before we bid for it, one of the things we look for is management and culture fit. In a software services delivery business, there will be times when projects will go south. That time we want both the companies to be absolutely culturally aligned. Right? We don't get it right always. And we also work very hard on explaining onboarding our customers. So customer onboarding, which starts even before the deal is signed, is very, very big in HCL. There is a whole customer onboarding program. There is a mobile app. As soon as you sign a deal with HCL, you will get a link to download a mobile app. You can see a lot of stuff, and we can talk a little bit about it later.
who's more powerful, the CFO or the CHRO of this organization?
Neither, it's the employees. And it's not a smart answer, because a lot of stuff is run by employees. Like, when we hire from, we usually hardly hire in marketing from, and I can talk about my team, we hardly hire from competition. We basically end up hiring from companies like Pepsi. And when they come, they're surprised. They're like, in our previous company, every ad film used to go to the chairman and CEO for review. And we're like, seriously, they had so much time? Because at a brand manager level in my team, they can approve stuff like that. So it's the employees.
Dedication.
Completely. Because you can't run a 110,000 people company growing at 20% in a bad year and expect it to scale.
Yeah.
So with all of this, with so much employee focus, and we are really talking only about you and the employees, how is your journey on you know, being the employer of the year award? And I'm not aware of the data, but how has that been? Is that a goal? Is that not a goal? Are you happy yourself?
So, interestingly enough, we've discussed this in our management meetings. We've never participated in it. And the reason we've not participated is a large portion of us have felt that our employees should feel the experience. And if others don't know about it, we're okay. It doesn't give us a kick to be number one employee of the year. Although in some markets like UK we have been employer of the year for the last 8 years. But it's not a data point which we speak about. It happens. Like, and if it doesn't happen, we don't lose sleep.
Yeah. What is really then the marketing for SEO? Because these surveys, right?
Great, I often end up thinking, what do we do? Why do I have a job?
No. How do you really create a brand for SEO? No? How do you make it visible to people outside when you want to hire talent or
thank
your
you.
Customers?
And thank you for asking that question. So the way we like to think of it is, marketing is not only communication. Brand equals to the business model. Which means, everything which I've been speaking about, if it becomes real, that's our brand.
Right?
110,000 employees, everybody has families, well-wishers. If they get our name out, we're done. All the customers we have in large companies like Merck and Cisco, we work with many people. If they get our brand out, we're done. You will never see a HCL ad at airports. You will never see us doing advertising above the line. It's a very, very grounded, work-in-progress company. We're not finished. So we don't, marketing actually focuses on a lot of transformation initiatives. I'll give you an example. A couple of years ago, we realized that a lot of people who join your company consciously or subconsciously decide whether they want to make a career in the company in the first 30 days. It's the first 30 days experience. How many of you are in HR? Some of you, right? And we said marketing will work with HR to create an employee experience program. And we call that program Farewell. Now, farewell is the term which is when you say for bye-bye. And what we said is farewell. You're joining HCL. You have to farewell. And we actually use design thinking to completely redo the employee experience in the first 90 days. We said, let's not leave it to the first 30 days. Let's extend it to 90 days. And if any of you are ever in Delhi, I can arrange for you to sit through it. But we are very proud of stuff like that. Marketing is not in the business of making brochures, doing another trade show. It is our competitive edge.
But won't above the line help you eventually, even though you're getting customer word of mouth? Like seeing in an airport or when you arrive in Heathrow or something, won't that add your brand? So what's the...
So you're right, Pahir, it will help. It is just that as a company, we realize there are a few things we can do well. And the moment you start not making an either-or question and doing an and equation, you start diluting focus. I can either do that big campaign with a movie star or a sports person, or I can focus on employee experience. And employee experience wins every time. I can focus on improving customer experience, or I can do hoardings. Customer experience wins every time. We might do it sometime, but are we ready for it? Is this the most important thing for us? No. with all humility, we are like only $6.5-7 billion. We are not the largest. There is a lot of work to be done.
You had mentioned about rehires in HCL, and you said majority of people do come back after 18 to 24 months because they go out for MBAs or whatever.
Yeah, or even join competition.
Or even join competition. So have you also, do you have any percentage of people who after rejoining, leave?
Continue.
Continue or leave?
I don't know the exact figures, but it's very high. And we have also seen the performance rating being very high.
So if people are, rehires are leaving again, don't you think that people are using HCL as a stepping stone and then going back to MBA and then coming back again and then taking up new opportunities?
Which is perfectly okay with us. See, think of it like, there is a book, it's actually called The Alliance. I don't know if some of you have read it. It basically talks about doing tours of duty. Right? So like it's a concept from US military. So you go for Iraq, then you go for Afghanistan. These are tours of duty. And there will be soldiers, there will be employees, there will be HCLites who will go out and come back. The company only wishes them well. HCL today has the highest number of CEOs in our industry are ex-HCL. They've all spent 20 years at HCL. And we wish them all the best. They still come in, they meet us. Yeah.
You said you don't track competition. How is the rate of...
I said we are aware, but we are not focused.
Okay, sorry, fair. So how has HCL grown? I know you've grown. How have you grown relative to competition? Okay.
Thank you. Thank that you. Brings me to the next slide.
So then,
and believe you me, I had not set up that question.
Well, then a follow-up, because as an organization gets larger, then it gets more and more difficult to maintain the culture, right? So you went from 35,000 to 110,000. So have you seen, since in the 12 years you've been there, have you seen a dilution? Because you're growing at the same rate, so it's not as if you're growing slower. But have you seen a dilution in the culture with the new culture, millennials or the kids?
So that's very interesting. A lot of our employees are very young. They're not even Gen Y, they're Gen Z. And the challenge in our industry or the exciting opportunity is when IT started growing up, we made manufacturing feel like old economy. And everybody wanted to work with the SAPs and the HCLs of the world. Today, e-commerce is making us look the same. Right? Everybody wants to work with the Jabongs and the Flipkarts and the next unicorns. We have not seen a dilution of culture. We've seen the culture getting morphed. Right? Because culture is not a product, it doesn't stay stationary. The core values, employees first, customer second, trust, transparency, flexibility, value centricity remain the same. Everybody in HCL will tell you the same thing. They don't carry a card in their pocket like a lot of MNCs give. They understand it, they feel it. Yes, but there are policies which get changed. Now, if you had smart service desk on an intranet, today all of HCL apps are on the phone. 100% of the company is mobile first. It's not mobile responsive, it's mobile first. If I want to book a cab, there is a mobile app for it. If I want to approve leaves, there's a mobile app for it. It's completely mobile only. So the way of delivery changes, the way of delivering employee experience, the way of delivering a customer experience, but the root tenets have not changed.
How do you deal with, how does HCL take tough decisions on employees with so much focus on employee for the decision of non-performers, counseling out, different from what you're experiencing?
I don't want to comment on my previous employers, but I think we believe in management by acceptance rather than management by rejection.
Rather than management by?
Rejection.
Rejection.
And let me explain what I mean by that. Management by rejection is the employee is not doing well, he's fungible, let's sack him. You can always hire another person. Management by acceptance is he's not doing well, we hired him. Did we go wrong? Or were we right and this is the wrong project for the employee? Can we work with him to change him? Can we enable and create a culture where he does well? Let's figure out making it work. So that's
I'm sensitive to the time. We have lots of questions, and I know we've been at it for a while.
We can carry on dinner time.
Yeah, we're going to carry on at dinner time, and we'll give you a little bit of a break. And I know, but I wanted to say before, while you have all their attention here, is there's something you want to say to them, or something that we didn't let you get to, because you didn't really get to.
Yeah.
I'll talk a little bit about the ideapreneurs and a little bit, because I have a little bit of time to do that tomorrow. But is there some last comment that you want to make?
Exactly. So what I'll do is we'll just quickly do some of the other stuff, and then we can carry on the conversation during dinner. So this is just a quick look. There have been times where it's narrow. There have been times where we've done really well. So our CSAT has really, really increased, more than doubled from 2005 to... this is an interesting idea.
What's the scale like, CSAT?
Sorry?
What's the highest value in CSAT?
Highest is, it's from minus 100 to plus 100. Right? Every HCL employee has access to a portal called a value portal. And value portal is a very interesting concept. It allows the employee to log in, generate an idea. And other than the manager, a lot of managers' peers are alert. The reason it's done is, we firmly believe that managers are so close to the project and so focused on delivery that they will tell the employee at times that, focus, get back on billing. What are you doing? Right? This is outside your job description. So when the idea is generated, it goes to everybody other than the manager. They mentor the employee and they nurture the idea and help the employee create a business case out of the idea. And once this is done, then the manager is alerted using the system. And at the same time, the sales lead is alerted and the delivery head is alerted. Together, they nurture the idea and then it's shared with the customer. 44,500 ideas generated till now. Phenomenally successful program. 14,400 implemented. And this is all audited. There is a report submitted. Nearly $1 billion in value added beyond the contract. So in a lot of our customers, you will actually have our delivery leaders walk up and present a check for a notional value, saying that this is $10 million beyond the contract to this order. This is really interesting. This is a quote from one of our CIOs. Now, we had never had a positioning line. Now, for any of you in marketing? No. Positioning line is basically Nike's equivalent of just do it.
Yeah.
Right? We had never had it. And we started getting asked as we became bigger. Same, why are you not advertising? Why are you not there in billboards? And we have something called Customer Advisory Council, which is a group of about 80-90 CIOs who meet us every quarter to critique HCL and give us feedback. It's a two-day meeting every quarter. And we told them we are terrible marketers. We'll break you into groups of five. And your job is today's assignment is you are the CMO of HCL and come back with a positioning line for HCL. We don't get it. There is some reason you bought HCL. Now, explain to us, why did you buy HCL? So they came back with three things. They said HCL employees are highly engaged. They are very progressive. Huge amount of diversity, employees first, leadership, skin in the game, and very, very capable. Flawless delivery, like outstanding engineering DNA. A lot of software inside Boeing 787 is written by HCL. So HCL is known for mission-critical engineering. We do some vanilla stuff, but most of it is very, very core to the client business. And we ask them, three is too many. We can't go to market with three. You have to select one. And they finally selected and they said, HCL actually goes beyond the contract. Employees work between 9 to 5. HCL entrepreneurs go beyond that. And they actually take the brief beyond the contract. So they will often push us, they will tell us we are not making sense, and we love this highly engaged, interactive culture. And out of this came our campaign called Relationship Beyond the Contract. This is just some CIOs of very large companies validating it. These are large analyst firms in our industry who have actually heard our customers say it. Clients praise HCL for its flexibility in managing relationships. Unwritten flexibility. Right, very, very strong relationship between two companies. Every customer we have entered, our customer retention rate is almost 100%. From 1999 when we were listed, it's almost 100%. We've never lost a customer. There are some customers which are filed for Chapter 4 and it happens. We've never lost a customer. All customers have grown. And employee investments, so. Now, this is an interesting slide I wanted to leave you with. This is the growth, right? It's about, depending on the day and the hour, between $18.5 billion to $22 billion in market cap. Last year, one of my personally very proud achievements is without doing advertising, without doing holdings, HCL entered brand finance top 500 brands in the world at 493. It was the fastest growing global brand out of the top 500. Last year, for the first time, we entered Interbrand, which is a large brand consulting firm, top 40 Indian brands at number 19, and the brand value grew by 63%. This year's report just came out yesterday. In fact, the ceremony was in Bombay, and we moved one notch up to 18. And this year, we have grown at 28%, again, the fastest growing Indian brand. So my personal dream is to make it a top 100 brand globally, and not do it by doing conventional marketing, but actually creating a difference to employees and customers. With that, some data on CSAT. Again, growth. Yeah, this is an interesting tidbit. This is the last slide, actually. So one day, you know, we were looking at the Bloomberg terminal, and we noticed that we are only one of the 8 companies which was listed in the 21st century and actually has $1 billion in net profit, $5 billion in revenue, and $15 billion in market cap. The other companies are Facebook, Seagate, Accenture, TCS, Baidu, Alibaba, and Google. The even more interesting and the data point which makes us even more proud is there is a leading analyst firm called Forrester. Now, Forrester does a customer satisfaction survey. Not done by us, done by Forrester. They reach out to whichever customer they feel. For 2 years in a row, HCL has been the highest in customer satisfaction across all named competition. This is a 2000 CIO survey. Very, very deep for 2 years in a row. And actually, our customer satisfaction scores have gone up. And if you wondered what is the maximum, it is 5. By the way, the question which we got asked is, why are we not 5? Thank you. And I'll leave you with the
advice first. I have a question. Yeah. Since we are in an academic setup,
yeah.
Yes. I just wanted to ask one question. You said that your CSAT score is to 56.3 in 2015. Which I believe was 58.6 in 2014.
Yeah.
So what?
Why did it drop?
Yeah. Why did it really drop? Actually.
So one of the interesting things we have seen is, in large deals, the transition phase is the most complex. And often in transition phase, so last year we signed a huge amount of deals, and we learned a lot on what not to do, what to do, and our CSAT took a hit in the transition phase. A lot of those deals were going live. Huge deals in Nordics, in continental Europe, where language is a challenge. There are cultural complexities. But I think this year we'll be back on that.
So what I would like to, actually, if I could ask you one question, then we're going to go to dinner. What keeps you up at night, sir? And how did you, just because we want to, as you can see, this is new day. I don't know that we have all this in the latest case, so I'll have to figure about that. But I want to tell you that when I first wrote the HCL case, and the case is called, if those of you looked at it, the question you ask is, should you tell your customers about employee first, customer second?
Yeah.
That's the action question. And that is even more lively than Wolfgang Keller. People's beliefs about that one. But I got a phone call from, I remember, the Business Week asking me, was it really true that Vineet's 360-degree feedback was up on the intranet? And they said it couldn't possibly be true. And when we first taught the case at Harvard Business School, you actually allowed people to explore your intranet because people couldn't believe that there was as much transparency as is being described here. I will tell you, it is this transparent. You just have to trust me about that. There is an unbelievable amount of transparency on what's on that intranet. It is the richest intranet I've ever seen for people to have information about what the financials are, what's actually going on, how people feel, what are the questions that people are actually asking, what are they complaining about. it is truly the dirty laundry is completely on there. So having seen that in two sections of Harvard executives were allowed to explore the intranet and see that, and there's tremendous amount of transparency in the system. I also, you know, I was very casual about introducing you, but we are very, very proud of what you've been able to accomplish, and I know you
are.
One thing that is very embarrassing for me as a person from the United States is I also go periodically to the analyst meetings, you know, when HCL comes to talk to their analysts.
Yeah.
And one of the first meetings I went to, which I think maybe it was Fidelity was holding it. I don't know. I was in there, but the two analysts that first stood up said, isn't HCL going to lose its capability to be so powerful because now you've brought in people who are from the U.S. and from Britain? They don't work as hard as people from India. So these financial analysts literally asked the question, we're really worried about what's going to happen to you now that you are not mostly Indian. So we'll have to continue on, and I was like, oh no, you're talking about me. But anyway, but what I wanted to say is a really very serious, what does keep you up at night? And you know, you did join the company, and obviously you took the leap or whatever. But what was hardest for you about actually adjusting? Because many people did leave. Many managers
weren't.
I just want to be clear, when you read the case, you'll see that part of it. But what was hardest for you, and what's keeping you up at night now?
I think the hardest part was realizing I'm responsible. So, at any level, I think, I don't know whether it's an Indian cultural trait, or it was just me, or it was just people around me, a lot of us felt when we started that we should look at someone else for answers. Look up, look sideways, look down. The hardest thing for me was realizing it's me. Internal locus of control, be the master of your destiny, and the buck stops with you. And own up to the decisions, take the decisions, apologize later. So it's a conscious relearning, unlearning. And Linda, your second question, which is what keeps me awake? I think marketing is not the most important thing I do at XA. For me, it's personally hiring. Everybody from a summer intern to a director marketing who works for me, 100% of hiring is done by me. Or at some level, I meet them, interview them. We firmly believe it is the most important thing as we grow. We have to hire people who have the same beliefs, value systems, and who are entrepreneurs. And it is a very, very polarizing company. Over time, we have realized people either hate us when they join us, or people love us. There is no ambivalence. So what keeps me awake is we will make a wrong hire, and at times we do. But we try to get our hiring right. That's the most important.
Well, thank you very much. And this man is about to become an author.
Thank you.
I don't want you in my space, okay? You're trying to write. He's actually working on a book. Finished his book much faster than I did.